Welcome to this podcast of International Dermoscopy Society, in which I'm going to show you some melanoma simulators, some cases that are commonly found in our clinical routine and clinical practice. First example, this is a patient with multiple seborrheic keratosis, and as you can see, some of them have been also subjected to cryotherapy. What happens in this scenario? The patients come because of the cryotherapy and saying, you know, I have erythema and some itch, let's take a look. And this is the first time we saw the patient, so we're starting checking also the other seborrheic keratosis, the ones that were not subjected to cryo. And what happens is that we looked with our dermatoscope. And case by case, this is just an example of some of the lesions that we took photos of, we noticed that among the seborrheic keratosis that clinically were completely undistinguishable each other, we found one lesion, the one on the upper right, that is not a seborrheic keratosis, but indeed it's a melanoma. So here, clinically, we do not recognize clinically the lesion that is a melanoma, and we have several seborrheic keratosis, so we should look with our dermatoscope to any kind of lesions to discover this melanoma in situ. This is a melanoma because it has the atypical pigment network and also the irregular pigmented areas inside the lesion, even though there are some few milia-like cysts, but these are also a common finding in melanoma. So we know well that seborrheic keratosis could be mimicker, but also some melanomas mimic seborrheic keratosis on the other side. And these two cases of our case report reveals that in case A, we have a varicose surface with some pinkish and hyperkeratotic in hyperkeratosis in the center. In case C, you know, clinically we have a pinkish papule, and dermoscopically we notice only hyperkeratosis and pinkish background and milia-like cysts. However, case A and B is a varicose melanoma in which we recognize the features of melanoma because of the presence of pigmentation highlighted by the arrows, but we can recognize this tumor as such only if we use our dermatoscope. Since seborrheic keratosis are actually a mimicker, but also some melanomas look innocent, we did a big study under the umbrella of the IDS, and we said that the seborrheic keratosis, like melanomas, can be dermoscopically challenging, but the presence of blue-black sign, the pigment network, usually this pigment network is located peripherally, pseudopods, streaks, blue-white veil, can be regarded as specific melanoma features and should raise our suspicions that indeed it's not a sep K, but it's a melanoma. And this is another beautiful example of a melanoma resembling a seborrheic keratosis, in which you see clinically a lot of hyperkeratosis, but if we look with our dermatoscope, we observe at the periphery the presence of tiny globules and pigmentation that are clues definitely related to melanoma diagnosis. So if we have an hyperkeratotic lesions, please use your dermatoscope and check for melanoma specific criteria, not in the area where you have the hyperkeratotic surface, but in the area where the lesion is more flat. And here are the highlights. So the golden rule is to examine with our dermatoscope all lesions, even the ones that look innocent, even the ones that look seborrheic keratosis under a clinical examination. So among seborrheic keratosis, when we have the nodular seborrheic keratosis, we should always look with our dermatoscope. But in these three cases, we observe, you know, the cerebriform appearance, the white color and the particular vessels of the seborrheic keratosis, and no other features of melanoma. So we are sure that this is a seborrheic keratosis. There are no melanomas in this tree, in this panel. The challenge is when we have the so-called melanocantoma-like. So seborrheic keratosis that are heavily pigmented, and these are just, four examples of pigmented hyperkeratotic lesions that clinically resemble seborrheic keratosis, and dermoscopically we should be very careful when checking. We have the case on your left, in which we have a very sharp demarcation, the presence of fat finger at the periphery. Case number two, we have, this black color that is due to the comedo-like openings. And then we have case number three that is more different from the others, and case number four, in which we have, the presence of hyperkeratosis. So we have one nodular melanoma among these four cases, and this is a melanoma because if we look carefully, what we notice is the presence of network. Remember, network is always at the periphery, at the base of the lesion, and ulceration in the center. Ulceration is not a typical finding in seborrheic keratosis that usually have hyperkeratosis. When we have ulceration, we should cut it out the lesion. But with this in mind, we have always to think about melanoma criteria, so the presence of network is suggestive for melanoma diagnosis 100%. And here, even at the edge, we see some pseudopods and blue-white veil. When we have, nodules that are hyperkeratotic with ulceration in the center, okay, we should again look at the dermatoscope examination, dermoscopic examination, and we have on the left the presence of hairpin vessels with white halo. In the center, ulceration and whitish area, in the background. And on the left, we have another clue that is the presence of white color, but also the presence of gray dots that are visible at 6 o'clock, more or less 8 o'clock, of this lesion. So we have some idea. But the idea is that the first one is a seborrheic keratosis, okay, fitting very well with our dermoscopy. The third case is a basal cell carcinoma, and if we look at the periphery, we see the presence of dots. But the case number two is a nodular melanoma that dermoscopically is completely undistinguishable from a squamous cell carcinoma, in my view. So what happens in case number two? We have the clinical examination that is more relevant compared to dermoscopy alone, because the case belonged to this man. This is a 45 years old man and a relatively young patient with a solitary nodule on the belly. Clinically, there is no sun damage at all, you see, and this is not fitting with the general scenario that we have for a squamous cell carcinoma. So the take-home message is that when you have a nodular lesion located without sun damaged skin in a young patient on the abdomen, even if dermoscopy could look suggestive for squamous cell carcinoma, melanoma cannot be ruled out based only on dermoscopy, but should we always have to integrate together clinical endoscopy. And furthermore, in case of ulceration that is covering more than 50% of your lesion, you should excise the tumor, the nodule. And moving to the nodular lesion, basically what we see as the most frequent tumor is the basal cell carcinoma, pigmented or not pigmented. We have the squamous cell carcinoma and the melanoma. If we look, in general, these are the most frequent nodular diagnosis. And now some example again. If I show you just this four dermoscopy picture, all the nodules are typified by the presence of this purplish background with some whitish color. But, based only on dermoscopic view, it's more difficult to get some diagnosis. We have more or less, the possibility of melanoma, basal cell carcinoma, Kaposi sarcoma, lymphoma, vascular proliferating lesions. So many, many possibilities. However, look at the clinical together. We have in the first case the back of a young man without sun damage. In the second case, the back of a man with few nevi. In case number three, multiple nodules. So we are not dealing with one single nodule. And in the last case, again, the leg of a man with a solitary nodule. So now, with this information in mind, Just try to see the scenario. Of course, in the multiple nodules, we think about Kaposi sarcoma. And on the other side, in the less case, we have the features to recognize the basal cell carcinoma because of the arborizing peripheral vessels and the gray ovoidal nests that we see. But what about the other two cases? The other two cases were nodular melanoma and melanoma metastasis. Why? Because those lesions were solitary. They do not display any features specific for basal cell carcinoma, and they were located on the back, that is a common site for melanoma. So when we do not have specific melanoma criteria, always think about melanoma, especially when there are no recognizable features for common tumors. And the basal cell carcinoma on the legs, please remind, you have to remember that it's a chameleon. So sometimes on the leg, we have features of the basal cell that are not so classical, let's say, like in this case in which we have a lot of white color. And finally, the lesions with eccentric pigmentation simulating melanoma. It's a common finding to have, especially in patients with multiple nevi, lesions revealing two pigmented components. And this is the clinical view of some example. You see, we have hypopigmented area and hyperpigmented area together. And here again, clinically, we have the same two different components. And from a clinical point of view, it's very difficult to tell which is what is benign and what is malignant. If we look dermoscopically, we see that in the first three cases, so we have two components. So the idea that we got doing a study, but it's just something to help us to recognize the single component, is to try to think to the component in a separate way, like using, for example, some trick to exclude the more, let's say, homogeneous pattern. And if we focus only on the hyperpigmented patch there, we see that taken together, if you consider just only that portion, the eccentric one, it's a reticular benign. So in this way, we are more, we can actually make an easier diagnosis of benign lesions because those were nevi. A complete different story when we have the eccentric pigmentation that reveals the presence of atypical features, and the typical features are, you know, easily recognizable even without splitting the lesions in two, because we have the atypical network that is, with hyperpigmentation in the center and tendency to have streaks and irregularity. And so the difficulties is to actually think to consider separately the two components. And these were nevus-associated melanomas. Of course, there are several melanoma mimickers and benign lesions stimulating melanoma, but with this short podcast, I would like just to share with you some examples and some cases. Thank you for your attention.